For more on the developments of the last 24 hours, I'm joined now by two people with deep experience in Libya. Robin Wright is a journalist and author who knew Ambassador Stevens personally and has reported extensively from Libya and the wider Middle East. And Frederic Wehrey is a senior associate with the Carnegie Endowment for International Peace. Robin Wright, tell us about Ambassador Stevens.
Chris is an extraordinary envoy in that he understood the streets as well as the elites. He spoke the language, he understood the culture. And he had seen Libya through all through three of its phases. He spent 2 years as the number two during Muammar Gaddafi's rule at the American Embassy. And then he spent a year during the transition as the liaison to the Transitional National Council in Libya, based in Benghazi. And then he returned to establish the American Embassy in the post-Gaddafi era. And he really was tremendously thoughtful, and he was willing to get out, even facing the extraordinary dangers of a country with 300 militias going through a fragile transition and trying to kind of change a country that had been the nemesis for the United States for 40 years into an ally.
Frederic Wehrey, based on your experience on the ground in Libya and in Benghazi in particular, did any of this surprise you? Did it seem unusual? The latest reports we're hearing is that this attack was actually planned.
Tragically, I think there were a lot of indicators that this was coming. What you had was, since the July 7th elections in Libya, security really declined, especially in Benghazi. And this was really unnoticed by a lot of the Western press. You had almost daily incidents of car bombings, attacks on Gaddafi officials, rocket attacks on Western icons like the Red Cross, and in May, an attack on the consulate in Benghazi. So this was not the first of its kind. This is really a problem of the weakness of the government and the weakness of the police forces throughout the country.
But one of the things we've been hearing, to the extent we've been hearing anything from Libya, is how welcoming Libyans were, and how even Ambassador Stevens had been quoted as saying how much better things had gotten. Was he misguided, or were we?
Oh, I think the majority of Libyans are overwhelmingly welcome of the United States and the role of NATO in facilitating the transition to post-Gaddafi rule. But as you saw in Egypt as well, there are a small group of extremists, hardliners, ultra-conservatives of different ilks who are sensitive about the role of the United States, in the case of Egypt, inflamed by a film about the Prophet Muhammad, that play into passions. It may also be that you have an al-Qaeda affiliate involved in some way in the Libyan attack. We don't know, but there are early indications that what happened in Benghazi and in Cairo may actually have slightly different causes.
There may have been a retaliatory effect here, we think, perhaps. There are so many versions of what may have been the spark.
Absolutely. And I think, just to echo, I think Libyans, you know, culturally, temperamentally, historically, are not predisposed to support this sort of violent radical Islamism that is motivating these attacks. In many of the previous instances of violence, you've seen Libyans mobilize in protests or on social media against the violence. And as Robin mentioned, this is a country that is still very grateful to the West for the intervention that toppled Gaddafi.
What do we know, Robin, about this video, this film, whatever, however you choose to describe it, that was posted some time ago online and suddenly caught fire this week?
Oh, very little. There have been different reports in the first 24 hours about who may have been behind it, different sources, people from different parts of the world, different religions, and it's kind of dangerous to get into that turf until we really know more about where it came from. But it did portray an excerpt from it that was put on YouTube, actions by the Prophet Muhammad that people in the region felt were sensitive, in the same way that people of Christians might feel about the portrayal of Jesus in controversial. This is a sensitive issue for people of all faiths, and Muslims at this particular juncture so sensitive about the role and intentions of the outside world in countries as they are reclaiming control of their own faith and fate, political fate, you know, can trigger exceptional or extraordinary responses. But again, by a tiny minority, when you look at Egypt, 2,000 people in a country with 85 million people, that's almost infinitesimally small. But it happened on 9/11, and it was something that echoed the takeover of the U.S. Embassy in Iran in 1979. So it clearly inflames us as well. And the tragedy is that this is a very small minority of people, I think, in both countries.
Tell me about the Salafi Muslims. What role do we think they may have played? They have been stirring up some of this?
Well, they've certainly been behind a lot of the attacks in Libya against Sufism, which is a variant of Islam that they regard as heretical. They've attacked other Western targets. My reading of the Salafis in Libya is that they're such a marginal minority, and Libyans are really predisposed to a more moderate interpretation, and we saw this in the elections. That the Salafis are grasping at relevance, and they're trying to rattle their sabers, they're trying to muscle their way to prominence through this violence. And this is not the strategy of a movement that has grassroots support or a winning movement. So again, they're a fringe movement. That said, they can still cause violence, they can still play a spoiler role, and importantly, they're highlighting the weakness of the government. And what you're seeing is a lot of Libyans, they're mad at the Salafis for this attack and for other violence, but they're turning their anger toward the government. And they're saying, why aren't you providing security?
One of the interesting things is the difference between the reaction in Egypt and the reaction in Libya. The Libyan government came out. We heard the prime minister denounce this. The U.S. ambassador from Libya to the U.S. also denouncing it. We haven't gotten the same response in Egypt for the breach of the U.S. embassy there.
Yes, it was very striking, the different responses in Tripoli and in Cairo. And I think that was a sub-theme of the remarks by both the Secretary of State and the President today, acknowledging the immediate and heavy-hearted response by the Libyan government, the role that the Libyan security forces played in trying to fight back those who were mobbing the consulate in Benghazi, and then trying to save Ambassador Stevens and his colleagues. And by the absence of words about Egypt, it was almost as if saying, and where were you? And I think this is a tragic moment, the timing of this, not just because of 9/11, but also because both of these countries need U.S., in the case of Libya, technological help, and Egypt, financial help, to deal with the issues that triggered the uprisings in the first place. And you just had 100 top-level executives from American corporations in Cairo to talk about private investment, helping create jobs, which is what really is so critical in stabilization. And these kinds of attacks in Cairo and Benghazi undermine American faith, business, or diplomatic, in the future of these countries.
I think most Americans look back at the Arab Spring and think, good, done, that's all taken care of. But instead, I wonder if both of these events happening within 24 hours in two different capitals should be sending us some sort of warning signal, something that the U.S. should be aware of, on alert for.
Well, I think it's an indication that revolutions are a long-term process, and the initial victors can sometimes lose out to more radical actors. And I think, importantly, the international community should not disengage from these countries, and especially in Libya. I mean, the country is grateful for our assistance, but they also need more assistance in building representative institutions and especially building their security forces.
Chris's message would have been, do not waver. That's the one thing he would have wanted more than anything, that this commitment to try to help stabilize fragile democracies is really what he had devoted his life to. And that the challenge now is to instill the rule of law and help them not only find those who perpetrated, but to bring them to justice in fair trials, and to be a contrast to, for example, the execution of Muammar Gaddafi, but to put them on trial in ways that reflect that these are new democracies committed to the principles of law and order.
That's what we'll be watching for next. Robin Wright, Frederic Wehrey, thank you both very much.
Thank you.